Hello everyone, this is Priyanka and good morning to you all, and I hope you all are enjoying the rain. So I hope you all can hear me.
Yes.
So I would like to start our today's session, and I would like to welcome you all on the session, which is sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft, and this meetup is organized by APC community. And today's meetup, a virtual meetup, is on AI solutions with Azure Deep Learning. So we will move forward to our community. So our community name is Azure Tech Community, and under this community we have started this live AI on Azure meetup series. So Manish sir, can you just move towards the next slide? Sorry guys, we are having some network issue, just give me a 2 minutes. So under this Azure Tech community, we have organized some meetups and online webinar series. So if you want to join our community and get updated about all the meetups and events and online webinars, you just go to the meetup and search for Azure Tech community or emerging technology.
Your
community.
Voice is a lot of disturbance, ma'am.
Okay. Just give me a second. Can now you all hear me clearly?
It's better.
Yeah, it's better.
Yes.
Yeah. So basically, if you want to get updates about our upcoming events and virtual meetups and webinars, you just need to follow us on our community channel. And once you follow, you will directly get updated about our upcoming events. So moving forward to the code of conduct. So basically, when
we lost you.
Hello. Yeah, even I can't hear.
Yeah,
same here.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I'm very sorry for this network issue. So this is a code of conduct. So we are organizing such big amount of events and webinars. So there is a code of conduct we need to follow. So you can't take the screenshots or photographs and of these presentations. And also you can't record these sessions. If you want the recording, then you just need to follow our and subscribe our YouTube channel. So from once you subscribe the YouTube channel, you will directly get the updated videos of our events. So moving towards today's session. So today's session is on AI solutions with Azure Deep Learning. So basically, when we're talking about the artificial intelligence solutions, we need a system that can take a decision and do some things in advance for us. So innovations in deep learning algorithms and hardware are happening at a rapid pace. It is a no longer question of should I build AI into my business, but more about where do I begin and how do I started with AI. So today's session is about answering of all these questions about the AI and how AI is working with deep learning. So our previous session is already took by Navjyoti Boraha. So I would like to give some quick brief about our today's speaker. So Mr. Navjyoti Bora is a real gem in this mine of technology and AI industry. He is an AVP technology and learning services at Synergetics. He has experienced his experience is more than 30 plus years in this IT segment, and he has offering best guidance to many Fortune companies regarding their enterprise integration solutions. And he is a MCT, MCSD, MCTS. He has completed all his certifications in this technology, and he has handling app modernization architect solution based off Microsoft Azure cloud platform for multiple MNCs, not only in India, but in USA, Singapore and Sri Lanka. And he has hands-on development experience in languages like .NET, Angular, React, Python, Node.js. Also, he is expertise in technologies like Azure PaaS, LaaS, DevTools, OSS, then mobile development platform as well. And he has working on many projects of AI for many years. Now, all you can know why I have said that he is a gem of technology. And I'm sure he will definitely give you an answer about regarding the all the AI related doubts, deep learning. So moving forward to today's session, but I would like to give a quick announcements regarding our upcoming events and webinars. So we have started this live AI on Azure meetup series, and under this series we have already completed two virtual meetups. Today's is third meetup, and there is one more meetup from this series which is on 18th June. Then I would like to give you an announcement regarding the Python workshop. So under this we are going to take a Python workshop and Python webinars. So this is in Python workshop, there are two workshops on 6th June and 28th June, and two webinars which is on 11th June and 25th June, as you can see our screen. So basically in the workshop, it is a one whole day training only in workshop. So the training is for 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and we are taking limited registrations from one company. So if any member from any company, there are 10 members from one company, we will only took 5 members. So if possible and you want to attend this whole day training, so then you need to register for this workshop as soon as possible. So also we have started a webinar series. In that series we have already done two webinars. So one webinar is left, which is on DP100. So this webinar is on 19th June. So if you want to register for this upcoming webinar, you can register. And if you have missed previous webinars, then you just visit our YouTube channel, subscribe our channel. After that, you will able to see our webinars. So one more announcement about data and AI certification campaign. So Synergetics has this very interesting campaign. So under this campaign, there are 4 certifications: DP100, AI100, DP200, and 201. So if you, this campaign is from 19th May to 19th June, and if you completed any one of this certification till 19th June, then you will stand a chance to win a Microsoft Surface Go. So there are 4 simple steps, as you can see my screen. You need to register, you need to complete your certification before 19th June. Then you need to post that certification and badge on your LinkedIn account, and you need to tag Synergetics as well as Microsoft in your post, and then you will eligible to for a win Microsoft Surface Go for a lucky winner. So moving towards more details about small detail about this data and AI campaign. So we are offering a training. And the original cost of this certifications, as you know, in the market is more than 35,000. So we are already giving the discount on this certification, which is 17,500. But under this campaign, if you register under this campaign, you will get the training only in 15,000. Then we are also offering free live monitoring sessions. There are 10% discount on exam vouchers as well. And for the calendar, you can visit our Synergetics website. In that, you will access the public training calendar. So you all know why these certifications are important to us. We are fighting with this COVID situation and everything. So we need to, while we are sitting at just home, we need to upgrade ourselves with the certifications, and it will give a very good boost to our career. So there are four reasons to complete your certification. Also, we have conducted a webinar on how to take a online exam just by sitting at home. So if you want to attend this webinar, or you have any questions regarding how to take a exam from your home, just visit our YouTube channel. Once again, I'm saying that because we have already posted a webinar recording on that channel. So you will get all the answers. So here are, we have also shown our public calendar for this certification. So you can see a calendar for the upcoming calendar for the certification. So this is our small initiative of giving you a live training plus MOC and plus exam voucher in just 17,500 rupees. This is a different from the data and AI campaign. Under the data and AI campaign, there are only four certification. And if you register before 19 June, only then you will get that four certification in 15,000. This is a different calendar. It includes DP series, DA series, any, and Azure series. So this will you get with 50% discount, which is you will get 17,500 with live training plus MOC plus exam voucher. If you have any doubts regarding the calendar or any certification, feel free to reach us. I will share in the end of the session my mail ID. Also, the concerned person, which is Shilpa Awad, we will share the mail ID of hers with you. So we are giving this special offers and discounts till 15 June. So if you want to register and having any doubts, so just reach to us through a phone call or a mail. So that's it from my side. And last announcement. We are going to giving a participation certificate, and we need a little time. Once the webinar is over, meetup is over, we need a time to send you a feedback. Once you fill your feedback or survey form, after that, we will send the certificate to you. So it will at least for more than 7 to 8 days to send a participation certificate to you. So probably many of you haven't registered for these meetups or events. So we didn't have your data, your name, mail ID, contact number. So we can't give certificate to you. So I'm going to, as a process, I'm going to give you my mail ID in the end of the meetup. You will just need to mail me your details, and that your name, mobile number, and your mail ID, and saying that you have attended this today's meetup. And after that, we will send you a feedback form and survey form. And once you fill that feedback, we are going to give you a participation certificate. If you have any doubts regarding certification, campaign, upcoming meetups, and anything, just feel free to reach out. And we have asked a very interesting questions in our survey form, that if any one of you want to register, volunteer for our upcoming webinars or meetups, you want to be a speaker, you have enough knowledge so you can share with others. So just fill that survey form, and after that we will reach to you, and we will definitely organize some upcoming events or meetups with you. So thank you, Navjyoti sir. From this, you can take over.
Yeah, thank you, Priyanka. So let me pull out my PPT first. Hope everyone can hear me. This is Navjyoti, the yes. speaker for today's session. So once again, welcome you to this webinar. As you can see, the title of the webinar today that we are going to do is AI Solutions with the Deep Learning on Microsoft Azure Platform. So my name is Navjyoti Barua. I'm an AVP Technology at Synergetics. I have been associating with Microsoft and helping partners to enable Microsoft Azure services in different contexts, right from developing application, deploying applications, infusing different applications, app service into the existing application. So before I begin this today's session, so let me set the context, what we are going to do and what we are going to learn. Now, as you can see, a deep learning, the word that the deep learning as an area is really, really vast. It's really, really big. But we are going to identify a few tools and services on Microsoft Azure through which we can think of writing deep learning application or developing deep learning application. As I said, it's a really, really big domain, the vast areas. So the context of this today's webinar or the series of this entire webinar, what Azure has to offer in context of deep learning. But so before we move into a deep learning, we need to know a bit of not just the overview of machine learning, but you need to really know machine learning before you get into a deep learning. So that's why I'm saying that this is not going into a deep dive kind of deep learning session, but it will give you a fair idea what is deep learning, how it is being used in today's scenario, or what is there on Microsoft Azure platform in order to think of, or in order to develop, or in order to kind of deploy a deep learning solutions on Microsoft Cloud. So that is a context. So since, as I said, the deep learning is really, really a complex subject, because when you talk about deep learning, we talk about algorithm, we talk about different underlying technologies, so who really go and deliver a deep learning solution. But so it's a kind of we all of us, maybe a few of you, I do not know the background of yours, you may have gone and started looking at what is deep learning and what are the different tools or platforms where you can run your deep learning solutions. But yes, to begin with the deep learning, so we need to look at the few things. The first, we need to understand the concept behind the deep learning and then go and find out the kind of tools and services along with the platforms through which we can develop the deep learning solution. So it is all about learn. So learning the concept, learning different services, learning platforms, and then we start building a deep learning solutions using Microsoft Azure platform. Now, to set the context, like why do I have to go and learn deep learning? So the number one is we are aligning ourselves with an artificial intelligence. It means last session, what we have delivered, we talked about cognitive services. Now, Microsoft has a set of services with an inbuilt functionalities or capabilities. So those services is being exposed as an API, and we just call those API in from our applications to make our application more intelligent. Like there are different type of cognitive service we talked about in the last session. Either maybe related to the vision, so the talking about image and the videos, or maybe related to a text, some kind of sentiment analytics and so on and so forth. And maybe related to a videos, analyzing a videos, if somebody is speaking in the videos, so on and so forth. So when you talk about artificial intelligence as a kind of area, so then we started talking about cognitive function. As I said, we already discussed the cognitive services from Microsoft Azure platform. Although we could not give an example from all the cognitive service that we discuss, but we picked up one and start looking at how cognitive service can be consumed from our application in the last session. So in context of developing any AI applications, there are many technologies. It is not only a cognitive service, but to begin with the cognitive service and going with some kind of machine learning and deep learning. Now we need to differentiate between all the technology that is collectively used to develop AI application. As I said, starting with cognitives and going up to a deep learning along with the machine learning. And today we are going to see all those, the tools and services collectively use, to develop AI solution. But the primary focus would be a deep learning. So what would be a deep learning? How the deep learning is going to help in order to develop AI solutions from Microsoft Azure. Now, as I said, that as a deep learning concept, it is not only available on Microsoft Azure, because I'm trying to relate or I'm trying to map with the list of services available on Microsoft Azure who allow us to execute the deep learning algorithms or deep learning, models and so on and so forth. And that is the primary focus. So if we talk about deep learning as a general concept, there would be a lot of technology, a lot of platforms where the deep learning can be deployed or sort of deep learning can be implemented. Now, before we move into the deep learning, as I said, we need to know machine learning. Now, by the definitions, what is machine learning? So machine learning gives the computer the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. So typically in a traditional program, what we do? So we go and kind of write the code and then we go and execute the code and we get the expected output. This is how the traditional program we use. Now, how the machine learning is going to be used, what machine learning and how machine learning works, it would be completely different from the traditional programming paradigm. But at this moment, what we can understand, so a machine can learn. So we need to only supply the data. We need to go and feed the data to the machine. And machine can learn from the existing data. Right, so that is a kind of domain or that is a kind of implementations that happen typically under the machine learning. Now, going from the machine learning to deep learning, so the fundamentally both are the same. So maybe one could be a subset of others, but essentially both is going to deliver almost the same job that we have been talking about, because it's all about learning by itself. So to understand a both, suppose you have an X amount of data and that X amount of data has gone into a function called app and do some processing by calling that functions and gives an output called Y. So getting an Y is the objective at the end of the month, but how you're getting Y and in between X and Y, you implement the concept. And this is for all call for us called functions. And what type of functions that we'll be using in machine learning, what type of function that we'll be using in deep learning may be different. But going forward, what we are expecting to get out of this equations or maybe input would be the same. So as you go on, that will be, so the two main component that we are talking about under the artificial intelligence, machine learning, ML and DL. But as I said, the fundamentally both are the same, but the way that is being operated by using the middle layer in between an input and output would be different. And we need to understand how this middle layer that I'm talking about going to be operated in context of machine learning or in context of deep learning. Now, before we get into the deep learning, so to begin with, why do we have to go with the first machine learning? Now, the word is machine learning was aligned with initially with the data scientist, who knows about algorithms, who can write algorithm, who understand the data, who can map the data with the expected output and so on and so forth. So the idea was that, in order to write an algorithm, so you need to come from a math background or statistical background and so on and so forth. But in real sense, if today's world, we are talking about the developer who are responsible for developing an AI application. So they may not come from a math background, but still they would like to go and develop the AI application. So the questions coming back to us, do I really need to know the math or statistics in order to use machine learning or deep learning in my applications to make my application as an AI application, or maybe, the working with those technologies, infuse those technology into my existing application or new applications, do I really need to come from the math or statistics background? The answer is no, because when you go and talk about the real sense of code, like you can see there are a couple of libraries that we import. So this is like I'm talking about, this is goes for the developers. If the developer has to go back and write code like that, what you are looking at on the screen, like suppose you are importing a bit of APIs, like Keras is one of the APIs for in context of working with deep learning. And going forward, so you would be using bit of network. So we'll be discussing all those network, neural networks, how the deep learning perform their task in order to predict or in order to score on a particular model or in order to create a model on a given data. So by looking at the code, we don't need any mathematics or we don't need any kind of statistical background to write this kind of code. But this is a code which is basically going to deliver a deep learning solution. So we need to know the API who can deliver what we are looking for as a deep learning solutions. So API could be one of the API that we are using called Keras. So machine learning and deep learning exhibit comparatively a little mathematical theory, so rather it could be an engineering oriented. So it's a hands-on discipline in which the ideas are proven, really more often, theoretically. So going forward, we'll get to know how it would be important, but just coming back to the fundamental once again. So when you see a typical programming, so you have set of logic that you write in a programs and input the data and finally you get the output. This is what your traditional programming that I explained before also. But today we talk about kind of the machine learning. So what machine learning does? So machine learning is going to give me a rules that I can subscribe to in order to predict something going forward, or maybe sort of working with data and your answers. Like, for example, we need to supply a data and we need to keep asking questions along with the data, and we may come out with the initial answer. So both will be putting as an input to the machine learning, and machine learning will process those answer with the data and comes up with the rules or a models in context of machine learning language. And that rules can be subscribed by any applications in order to implement the outcome of the machine learning. So here it's let's machine learning figure out the rules based on the history of the data. All right, so this is just the setting context before we get and talk about the technology behind the deep learning or a machine learning. So as I said in the beginning of this presentation, so whatever we are going to learn about the deep learning, whatever we are going to learn about the machine learning before we get into a deep learning, so it all will come from the Microsoft Cloud platform. I'm repeatedly saying that there would be multiple tools. Without getting on the Microsoft Azure, we can go and create a deep learning or machine learning solution. But the context, the series of webinars that we are doing at this moment, that is around the Microsoft Azure Cloud platform. Now, as a developer, what technology do you need to learn? So the Python is one of the core technology, the language that you need to know. So because we have an upcoming session on the Pythons aligned with the data science and writing applications aligned with the cloud services and so on and so forth. And of course, the Azure Compute. So Azure Compute come along with maybe a virtual machines, or maybe a cluster of nodes, or maybe some kind of containerized applications, and so on and so forth. And at the same time, so you need to know about Azure Storage that we have been using. In fact, in my previous session also, I used the storage to store the unstructured data, or store a file from where the deep learning the deep learning algorithms or deep learning, the programming can read data. And of course, the Azure Machine Learning as a service, right? So this is something that we need to know, going forward. But yes, this is basically a primary technologies, or maybe the primary tools that you need to know. But in order to develop a deep learning solutions, you need to really know more than what we are discussing at this moment. Now, in a typical data science process, because see, AI, data science and analytics, these are all will be coming together, because so when you think of developing an AI solutions or an AI applications, there are a lot of underlying the technology use. Like other day we talked about, we have been using cognitive service. So what we said in the cognitive service, if somebody wants to get the metadata of a given image, they need to know what kind of image it is, what is there in that particular image, then we go and use the computer vision cognitive service from Microsoft Azure. But in context of using computer vision cognitive service, we have no clue how that particular cognitive service is going to give me the output by just providing the image to that cognitive service. So I have explained that there would be a machine learning, the trained machine learning model already available to understand the image, to read the content of an image, and then come back and tell us what is there in that image. So these are pre-built, you know, train models available that is being used by your cognitive service API in the background. Now, similarly, maybe there would be a trained deep learning model would be used by cognitive service to go and, you know, give me the output or give me something like result based on what I have asked in my artificial intelligence or AI application. But in a traditional concept, in a traditional learning or in a traditional machine learning, how it works, so what are the building blocks and how it is sequentially arranged? So we said you collect the data, you prepare the data because you need to eliminate unwanted data for the training. So that is called data wrangling and going with, you know, training that model. And before we actually go and deploy the models, you need to go and evaluate. So if you're not getting an expected result, maybe you need to keep doing retrain with more data, or maybe combinations of multiple data and so on and so forth. But eventually what we need to get out of this pipeline that we are talking about, you need to deploy a model, and the model can be reused in order to do a predictions from the AI applications as in web service or as an API, how we have been using the cognitive service. So this is you have created on your own, and you convert into your own API, and the underlying application is going to consume that API any given point in time. All right, so this is what we get in there, and coming back into the pre-built and the custom AI spectrum that we talked about before also. So rather we go and create our custom model, rather we go and create our own model and published as an API that can be consumed from my applications, we can go and get some pre-built, as I discussed in the previous the session also. It will keep coming back because it will be under the same concept that we are talking about at this moment. So this is what we talk about. At this moment, it is all about the name for all of us, you know. So if I have to go and look, or if I have to go and start thinking about working with machine learning or deep learning, so what are the things that probably we need to know going forward? It is not to be done in overnight, but this is going to give you a fair idea. So, okay, what is TensorFlow? What is Keras? What is PyTorch? What is Spark, what is scikit-learn, and so on and so forth. So you need to keep going back and keep looking at those deep learning, the tools, or maybe API, or maybe a platform, right? So, or maybe a libraries and frameworks and so on and so forth. But the last one is, you know, if you do something implicitly from your applications, but at the end of the day, you want to visualize everything. You want to draw some kind of outcome on the screen. So how you are going to visualize the data? Maybe by drawing graph, or maybe by plotting those dot on the graph, and so on and so forth. So that is for them also. For in that context also, you will have a visualization tools like Matplotlib, which is being extensively used in today's scenario. So going with that also, as I said, there are a few things that we would be learning mainly. So a data brick, And again, I say that this session will give you a lot of input in context of knowing things, in context of knowing different services. You know, these are the different services that we are talking about on Microsoft Azure. And some point in time, probably you'll be using all of them. So you talk about Azure Databricks. Now, what is Azure Databricks? So we need to know that. All right, so SQL Server or ML service are in T-SQLs, Python in T-SQLs, and so on and so forth. And
number
and Docker local container scorings and all these things, AKS. So essentially, since you are going to work on Microsoft Azure, and some point in time, as I said, you would be using one. So I will walk you through a couple of them. Like, we will be working with Databricks, we'll be working with Stories, we'll be working with Keras, we'll be working with bit of a deep learning, the pre-built models, and so on and so forth. You'll get a fair idea at the end of this presentation, but I'm saying that it is not all about you know, the one or two things. So collectively, you need to go back and learn all the services which is available on Microsoft Azure at this moment in order to develop AI application which is backed by data science or analytics services from Microsoft Azure. So you can see that, you know, when you talk about working with Databricks or Azure Machine Learning, because as I say, the machine learning and Databricks need to work on the existing data. Now, question is that where you are going to store the data. It may be a Azure Data Lake store, or maybe it could be an Azure Storage. So, or it could be a Cosmos DB, or it could be a SQL database. Who can provide the data? Because that is the data, that historic data that you are storing, or maybe a real-time data that you are storing with all the services which is available on Microsoft Cloud platform. And then you give it the data to Databricks, or maybe give the data to the Azure Machine Learning, you know, so, or maybe an SD inside, and so on and so forth. And you process those data by using different algorithms, which will come out of those, you know, the compute service which is available on Microsoft Azure, and getting them back to the underlying, the applications or a service, and so on and so forth. So it's a complete, you know, the ecosystem, as I said, it's a complete ecosystem of multiple services. We have to put them together. We have to link them together in order to think of developing AI solutions using not only just deep learning, using stories, machine learning, and deep learning, what we are talking about. So in this session, primarily, I'm going to focus on the Azure deep learning, Azure Databricks. Deep learning with the Azure Databricks. So we'll pick up and we'll go and create a Databricks service, and we'll show, or we will walk you through and how deep learning would be, how the Azure Databricks would be used to deliver a deep learning solution. And along with this, a deep learning, so we are going to go and work with this notebook. The Azure notebook along with the Azure Databricks. So this is something, you know, so you are going to see at this moment. So there are a whole lot of stuff that we typically do from the notebook. And this notebook is capable of executing arbitrary code written in Pythons, or maybe code coming from R code or SQL queries, or maybe shell command on top of the notebook. So notebook is going to give us that environment where we can go and write the data science oriented code using Python as a language and then execute and see the output. So you will be experiencing what notebook that I am referring to at this moment when you go and do it practically, the notebook. But it is one of this environment that is being extensively used on top of the Databricks. Okay, and allow us to execute all kind of the code that is related to the data science, and finally that would be incorporated into the AI application by subscribing or by calling the outcome of the Databricks or outcome of the processing that we would be doing inside the Databricks. So today's context, the deep learning application is being available around us. The deep learning, the concept is being used in multiple applications, which is representing different domain altogether. Then you can see that either it could be an autonomous vehicles or a language translations or a image recognitions or a speech recognitions or forecasting, you know, predicting something. And of course, the predictive analytics. So the most of this type of applications that we are talking about is backed by the deep learning concept. So as I said, it's a huge data to be trained using the deep learning algorithms to predict something in the near future. But we can't be very specific, but as I said, that deep learning would be used across the application. But when you stepped into a particular application and start looking at how that deep learning is being used in an autonomous vehicle or a predictive analytics or forecasting, then you can figure out step by step. But here we are talking about in general where the deep learning is being used. Now, to learn a deep learning in a context, in today's context, how we supposed to organize ourselves to learn. So we talk about best practice and concept and the code. So you need to learn by doing things. So like your machine learning, a traditional concept, you ask to learn, you are asking machine to learn. You are only providing a data. Similarly, you need to start talking about what could be the best practice, because it is other way around. So once you know a technology, then you come back to a best practice in traditional programming. But in deep learning, you started with the best practices. You need to know the best practices. Then you need to know the concept, how this deep learning could help or going to solve our day-to-day problem, and then finally go and figure out the kind of APIs or a kind of algorithms which is available around us and start coding around them and creating the AI solutions any given point in time. So in a traditional concept, what it does, you know, in typically when you talk about the machine learning, like suppose you have the four columns of data that has come under the features, like suppose, you know, you are hypothetically, suppose you are identifying an image with a couple of features, properties of that particular image, any given point in time, and that properties is being identified or properties is being presented by numbers or values, as you can see on the screen. So this is something what we talk about. So your input data with the features, M could be a number of features with the X amount of data with some kind of algorithms and you are supposed to get, or you are supposed to go and get an outcome model. So it's a pretty simple. It's a, okay, you go uploading some data, and you are telling what kind of data at the same time also, by labeling those data, by making easy for the machine learning to understand what kind of data you are uploading, what kind of data that you are giving for a training, that you can go and create a model out of it, and that model can be used for the scenario like predictive analytics, or maybe some kind of the forecasting based on what we are going to interact with that particular model. But at the same time, the deep learning also subscribe to the same concept, but the way the deep learning work is different from the machine learning. So deep learning, so all input, whatever an input that you are going to give, it's a flat data. Suppose you are inputting an image, and it will go inside a series of, or maybe layer of a network. This is something called neural network, like your human brain. Because if you ask somebody to identify something, and then that person will start thinking. So human brain will start working to identify that a particular object. And similarly, in deep learning also, your objects or your image will go through multiple layer of the neural networks. And those neural network is being backed by deep learning algorithm to understand what has come as an input. And finally, it will give an output. And you know, by learning themselves, by knowing the features by themselves, and they can say, oh, this would be the ultimate output that you have given as an input. So they can recognize what object or what image that you have given. So without typing a features, without explicitly going and telling what kind of input it is, unlike your machine learning. So deep learning can learn the features from the incoming input on their own. So that is why it is called as a deep learning, and that is why it is so complex. It's all about multiple layer of the neural networks that is going to happen internally. So that's why the amount of compute associated with the deep learning is really, really big. All right, so that is something that, so you can see the labeling could be done on this data, like in a, as a features. So iris setosa, or maybe, you know, so that is a type of flower that we are talking about, but that flower may have a multiple features, like, you know, the length or width or a petal length, or maybe petal wings, and so on and so forth. So these are input data, and then you label them with a particular identifications, as you can see on the right hand side. So labeling is being done in the machine learning, and you know, so then it's gone into the deep learning. If you go with the deep learning, so you know, deep learning can learn those features on their own from the incoming, and that's why it is fundamentally different from the machine learning. But ultimately, what machine learning does at the end of the day, giving us the model that I could use the model. And similarly, a deep learning also going to give us a model that we can use the model from the AI application to predict, to forecast, to do something very intelligent for our application any given point in time. So to just to make it more elaborate on the concept behind the deep learning and the traditional machine learning. So what happened in the machine learning? Suppose you upload an image. You have gone and, you know, say that, okay, this is the image that you want to predict at the end of the day. So you upload that image with a label of that particular image. And you go and apply algorithms in order to, maybe you can use a classification algorithms that you need to classify between the multiple images that you have uploaded. Maybe you have uploaded an image of cat or a dog or another animal, and you have asked the ML machine learning to classify across the images that I have uploaded. I have trained under a particular model, the trained data that we talked about. So the predictions can come one of them. So what would be the predictions for that particular data? So it could be either one of them based on the data that you have uploaded to the classifications algorithms under the machine learning. But in context of deep learning, the same image can be given to the deep learning classifications. And deep learning also going to go and do additional job that learn the features from the input or from the incoming image, and then say, okay, what type of image it? Maybe from your AI applications, if I use this model, deep learning model, so I can predict for a test image. So if I want to test an image against this particular algorithm, against this particular model that was created from the machine learning or a deep learning, so I should be able to predict a particular animal which was being trained, which is being learned by the deep learning, or which is being learned by the machine learning any given point in time. So this is, again, this is what we see at this moment, or this is what we can differentiate between the two type of a learning that is typically done by a machine any given point in time. Just give me a minute. So coming to the characteristics of the deep learning, this is something like giving you huge amount of training data, because you are not supposed to label them on your own. That's why you are asking the machine to do that, learn from the data. So you need to supply more data, unlike your traditional machine learning. So that is what the automatic feature extractions that we are talking about excels with, the raw or unstructured data and so on and so forth. So you can give any data to, based on the kind of data that you want to train, or maybe the kind of domain that you are working for. So it may not be always an image, it could be something else. Now, one most important thing that we need to understand, the computing is the core component going with the deep learning, because if I want to train the huge amount of data by using deep learning algorithms on a particular platform, the platform has to offer me a huge computing. So it means, so you may go a multiple CPU machines where the actual deep learning computations can happen. So it going forward, it would be a pretty expensive. That's why the cloud will come into the picture, because it is really impossible to buy infrastructure on-premise to, you know, to train a deep learning model, to train the millions of images that you would be putting against the deep learning model. So you need really huge compute power. So cloud is going to offer you that, because cloud is going to give you unlimited resources in context of compute. It is all about the pay as you go. As long as you are okay with the number of compute resource that you want to subscribe any given point in time to learn your deep learning model, So you can go ahead with that. So that is why the cloud as a context is so important. So it is not only just a compute things, there may be other services like, you know, we talked about storage, where I'm going to store those data. Well, we need to store somewhere. So whether I want to store them on the on-premise or whether I want to store them on the cloud storage, like storage account, typically that we have under our Azure environment. Now, the core of the deep learning that we talked about, saying that it is all about the neural network. So multiple layer of the networks where the data will flow from one network to another networks or interconnected network until you get the ultimate outputs, until you get an ultimate, you know, sort of the expected result or so on and so forth. So if you say this, you know, if it is different from a traditional the machine learning, because as I said before also, so neural network is a core or a backbone of a deep learning. So just to walk you through a couple of the concept, how this neural network and the associate, you know, the component to help us to go through the entire process, go through the entire pipeline, how this neural network would be executed once the neural network received the input data, X amount of data. So you can see right on the top, there are few, a term, the technical term. So as you go forward, that will be the part of your maybe a discussion later on, but at this moment, you do not need to go and go after those technical term that we will be discussing. It is all about just to give a fair idea, just to give you some kind of insight how the neural network is going to operate incoming data under the deep learning in order to get an output. So you can see all those things. So we'll go one by one. The first, maybe we are talking about the problem type. So problem type can be classifications or a regression. So I want to classify, as I said before, a type of images through a deep learning neural network. So then I said, okay, let me go and bring that algorithm. So who can classify from the deep learning, the pre-created algorithms, who can classify my image or my data that has come as an input. So here the classifications is being done in two. So one where we have orange and the blue. So we have got two classes of data. We want to train a model that gives some input data and can classify it as orange, that is one, or a blue, you know. So that is the ultimate goal that we are looking for. So in order to operate my deep learning, that is a neural network that we are talking about, this is the core, the brain behind your deep learning. So you're saying define a network architecture. You know, sometime back I talked about a programming, a snippet, you know, the programming snippet where the Keras is a deep learning API was included, and we go and, you know, write couple of statements where I keep adding a multiple layer of the neural network. So this is something what you call network architecture. So network architecture is going to tell us how many layers. So your complexity will increase, or you can make, or you can evaluate, or you can, you know, solve a lot of complex problem by adding more layers. So more layers means more complexity and more the result oriented things that you are going to get. So how many neurons in each data layer? So block, the building blocks that you can see. So these are the neurons that we are talking about. How the neurons is being connected to each others, you know, so that is also being defined. So as I said in the beginning, we don't need to go and learn the deep detail how things work, but I just need to give, because since we are talking about deep learning, so fundamental concept of the deep learning has to come out. That is what I'm just explaining. But going forward in our subsequent series of webinar, you are going to see, you know, all the neural network, how you would be building that neural networks that I'm talking about. So not today, maybe, as I said, in a subsequent webinar that we would be delivering, really get your hand dirty by creating the neural networks using different APIs and the tools that we talked about in the previous discussion. All right, so then we talk about the features, like as I said before, also define how the input data, the features, you know, 1 and 2 are provided to a model. Right, so where we choose to multiply the features and provide the result as an input. So that would be basically nothing but as an input. So additional labeling that if you want to do on your own, you can go and go ahead and do that. That it features that we said in the few minutes back. All right, so if we have to go and say, okay, identify or predict a kind of flower, then I go and say, okay, length of the flower or with the width of the flower or a petal length or a petal width, and all these things would be a features. And finally, the deep learning will keep learning and tell me what kind of flower is, what exactly that flower is all about. So that is all about features. So it will go as a column, X or X1 or X2 or whatever it may be. So we discussed in the past. So that is also another component of a deep learning input data. And again, the learning rate would be another concept under the deep learning. So what basically saying that the model makes a small changes during the each epoch. The epoch means which is a complete pass through the training data. You know, just how big control by the learning rate. Now the learning rate is important. Like suppose you can say the learning rate set to a particular number, in which rate that your deep learning has to learn in the input data. So there would be a best practice that you need to see. As I said, we need to figure out the best practice first to get your stuff done in the deep learning or machine learning that we talk about, because it is completely different from the traditional, the computing or traditional programming that we talked about. So in what rate your deep learning has to learn the data, identifying the features from the input data. So you cannot increase the rate or it cannot decrease the rate. So you need to go by a best practice. So if you speed up, then maybe you could not learn in between, so you have to come back. You know, you never know. So all those things will come, but you need to know that there is a learning rate, you know, a particular rate of learning that you need to set in a deep learning project. And that is something will definitely come while you do a programming using deep learning any given point in time. So another component is an activations rel u. So that is basically an activation function is a mathematical function that introduce the non-linearity to an output of the network, adding this enable the neural network to learn using richer hypothesis space that just linear transformations of the data input. So these are terms that is being extensively used in a data science, but at this moment, maybe it would be a kind of the high level concept. Right, so that is also being, going with, knowing those terms, it will take some time because this is what we are discussing at this moment. But yes, I mean, like you can explore later on while you really go and write your applications aligned with the deep learning concept. So again, going with regularizations or maybe rate, so that is a kind of smooth curves of the model so that it does not hug the training data too tightly and so on and so forth. And this is again, I'm saying I'll just quickly walk you through all this concept. Because it is just the beginning, until and unless we keep doing things, it would be really, really difficult to understand going forward. So practically, we need to jump in and see the few things in the beginning in today's session, because it is just a 2.5 hour session, right? So doing everything about the deep learning is not possible. So it is just a walkthrough to get a bit of ideas. What are the components in order to work with the deep learning, whether on the Azure or maybe in on-premise, or it may be some kind of private data center compute model. So then we run the training data at the end. So you go and run through network, and this is called the forward pass. And you know, so this is how the network will keep running on the data. And finally, you are supposed to get the required outputs by learning themselves through the network that we talked about. So this is a kind of pipeline that we talked about, you know, so given that we know the correct class and the class predicted by the model, so we can access this model's performance at the end of this each epoch, and the measure error is called as a loss, something like that. You know, there may be sort of not could be anticipated with the data that will go under the loss. So we are also going to go and show you a few things practically that to get an idea of what I'm talking about at this moment. All right, so this will basically to, you know, couple of things that I'm iterating at this moment, but yes, you can always look back and you know, the entire pipelines and different component associated with the pipeline and the definition of this component in the ecosystem of building the deep learning model until you come to a conclusion, until you get an output with a score on the given data. So that is something that we need to figure out any given point in time while I'm working with a deep learning here. All right, so this is also a kind of you know, the internal architecture of the neural network that we talked about. This is what the list of layers that we can talk about with the multiple the layer for a particular the problems, or maybe you know, so your data will come into those layer in a vector form. So as you can see that in the previous example also, we talk about the vector data, you know, so by putting them in a columns in a numbers, so x1 to x2, x3 or xn. So and those the block within the layer would be neurons. So who has the capability of, you know, evaluating, or maybe who is actively going to take part of the learning from this data any given point in time. So how those network is interconnected. So you can see a bit of And this is the, again, I talk about the kind of vector data, and that vector data has gone inside the deep learning neural networks and use a particular algorithms, the supervised DL algorithms, and a finding with the classification models and so on and so forth. And finally, we can pick up the classification models and working with those level to classify the incoming document. So in this context, you're analyzing a text in context of figuring out what kind of text is being written. So maybe talking about sentiment analytic, or maybe anything which is related to the text analysis that we can do by using classification models. So you can classify those texts by putting them under a particular categories. But data always comes to a deep learning in a form of vectors that we can see at this moment. Right, so this is the same architecture that we are talking about. So now let's talk about how do you experience this, the deep learning. As I say, the deep learning models or deep learning activities or deep learning experiments can be done on the top of Azure services. Now, what services that we would be using extensively to work with the deep learning? So maybe you can see a pipeline. We can get some image from the Azure stores, and then using Azure Databake through a notebook, we can use the deep learning algorithms to identify the data, and then we can make some kind of predictions going forwards or expose that model as an API, and that API can be consumed from a client application like a Postman. You know, that model could be reused. Maybe one or a multiple application is going to consume that HTTP endpoint any given point in time, and then see how the deep learning models can predict based on what training is being done on top of those underlying infrastructure that we are talking about. So along with the Azure Databricks, there are the platforms where we are going to work with our the deep learning model. So we would be using the API, the deep learning API, like the Keras and TensorFlow with that also. So in this demo, what we are going to go and talk about, we'll create an Azure Storage account and we'll upload a list of images. And then we'll go with the Databricks with the TensorFlow and the Keras to build a model, the deep learning model that we'll be talking about. And from that model, so we can create a kind of HTTP endpoint that could be called from an application. So calling from an application would be not part of this demo, but yes, we can really go and see how we can think of creating a model that could be used by some other applications any given point in time. Now, just quick introductions. What is Keras that we talk about? Keras is a deep learning API written in Python, running on top of the machine learning platform TensorFlow. So this is something. So what Keras does, it's empower the engineer and resources to take full advantage of the scalability and the cross-platform capability of TensorFlow 2.0. All right, so the TPU maybe the working with the transfer processing unit, as you can see that, you know, large GPU based computing power would be used. So let us go at this moment to work with the demo that I'm talking about, so that we can experience few things in context of deep learning on Microsoft Azure. So to do with the begin by, I'll go and create a storage account, then I'll go and create a data brick, and then I'll initiate a notebook, and in that notebook, so we'll go and write the deep learning code that we have written in the previous, we have seen in the previous slide deck, and try to figure out, try to train those images by taking it from the storage account. Okay, so let me go back to my so full screen. I'll be going back to once I go back to my management portal, so I'll get into the full screen. Just give me a minute. All right, so currently I am in my Azure subscription, as you can see that. So the first thing that I'll go and create my storage account. That is a storage account where I can store my images before I give that image to the deep learning algorithms, who can read features from the images and tell me what kind of images that I have given to the deep learning on their own by learning features from there itself. Just to give a kind of, so we need a storage. We are taking advantage of, I'll create a resource group. Storage account. So this is my storage account name. So I'll go with the rest of the default configuration. So deployment is being submitted. It is in process. In the meantime, so I'll go to another service that I need. As your Databricks, you can see. So what is basically an Azure Databricks? Fast, easy and collaborative Apache Spark based analytic platforms. All those high performance analytics operations can be done on Azure Databricks. So Azure Databricks is being associated with whole lot of Azure services, integrated with Azure services. So Databricks can talk to those services without crossing any kind of layer, because they would be in together in the same context. All those things. So let me go and create my Databricks also. I pick up my same group. we'll go with trial one, so networking, and rest I will be going with default one. I'll create that. So this deployment also being submitted. So I'll go to my dashboard. I pin my storage account. I go to the storage account. And then inside the storage account, I'll create a container. Give a name of the container. So I'm going to get a zip file of 2000 pixels of different objects. And we'll see what kind of objects, what kind of image, the 2000 image will come under this particular container. So I create a container. I'm going to upload a file. So let me go and get my file. It's a zip file that I'm uploading to my storage container. This is done. You can see the refresh. That is a zip file which is sitting inside that particular container. So deployment of Azure Databricks is going on, so we can just see the progress also there. So this is also done. I can pin it to dashboard. So this is my Databricks. And then from the Databricks, I go to the workspace where I supposed to write the code for executing the deep learning pipeline. So it will basically go and get my datas. Everything would be connected from this particular the workspace that I'm talking about. Maybe a storage could be one service from where the Databricks or the deep learning algorithm has to go and get those images that we have uploaded a few minutes back. Now, the first thing what we need to do in a Databricks, so first thing we need to create a compute resource. Like in Databricks context, it would be the cluster. The cluster that we are going to create, is going to give us the compute resources. The compute resources means the GPU, you know, or maybe the kind of the memories and so on and so forth. So it's like a cluster of compute would be made available in the Databricks in order to do all kind of computing that's supposed to be done for my deep learning algorithm or deep learning code that we are going to write. So then we'll go and create the cluster first. So here we go with the new cluster. So here you see, this is how the cluster is being made. So we can say a deep learning cluster now I can figure out what would be the compute resource that I want to provide to this particular cluster. So here I can go with the standard and default one, the cluster node, but I pick up, I see that the Databricks runtime version. And then I go and select this series of NC12 standard. So you can go and, but this is just for, and now it is all about the compute. And we do not need the auto scaling at this moment. And this particular cluster would be cooled down or terminate after 120, because running a cluster would be pretty expensive until you terminate that cluster, because the compute power that you can see that the compute power, GPU, you know, all the frameworks that is being assigned to this particular compute platforms is always come with the cost. So we can make it something like so we don't need any additional workers, that we are going to work on the default driver workers to do this one. Additional worker would be more expensive at this moment. So what I'm saying that this is a bit of configurations that I am doing. So how I want to provision or how I want to make my compute available, because I need the compute power. The compute power that we are talking about, 112 GB of memory, 2 GPU and 3 DBU, and all those Databricks unit that you are getting in order to in order to execute all the computing stuff that I'm talking about under this environment. So we'll go and create the cluster. So creating a cluster will take some time, maybe 5 to 7 minutes from now. So what we'll do at this moment, we'll take a quick break, and when you come back from the break, and by that time my cluster would be ready, then I'll go and walk you through the remaining steps of my demo to understand how deep learning on Microsoft Azure can be configured, or how deep learning model can be created on Microsoft Azure by using those the service which is available for us today. Okay, so let us take a break of 10 minutes. So we'll rejoin at 12 o'clock. Now it is 11:50. So let's rejoin at 12 o'clock, 10 minutes break. And then by that time, hopefully our cluster would be ready. And then subsequently, I will take you through the remaining steps of the demo to get a fair ideas what I have been talking about from the beginning of my presentations in context of implementing the deep learning and taking it to the the intelligent applications that we are talking about, the AI application that we are talking about. But core concept, what we are discussing, the core element that what we are discussing is deep learning. So deep learning going with the data scientist, deep learning going with the AI developer as well. So it's a broad area that we need to understand, the ecosystem of the deep learning any given point in time. So let's take a break and come back in 10 minutes. Max, can you put off your video?
Yes, I can hear.
People out there assemble huge numbers, but beyond that,
where are you from?
Maintaining social distancing and by ensuring that every child is accompanied with an adult, people can do their physical exercises and morning walks within the time limit given. So this
Max,
is
you have to stop your video.
By opening up for people.
Okay, so you want me to go to the cam and go to dog, right? Yeah.
Yes. Thank you.
For their arrests. There have been mass protests, not just in America, but in cities across the world, including London, since videos of George Floyd being on the social media. Now, the protests in the US continued over the killing of African American George Floyd.
Okay, so let us come back and hope. So my the cluster that I have created with those compute is now up and running. So now we can go to the workspace, or maybe I can go directly to my Azure Databricks. So now we can go and work with the notebook that we talked about. The notebooks allow us to run the Python code. As we said that we can run SQL command, we can run shell script and so on and so forth. So what we are going to do at this moment, so I'll go and get my notebook first by importing an existing physical file. So from the Azure Databricks workspace currently I am. So I can go and say, or maybe I can go with from here also, anytime that I can see. So here also, we can say import.
Can you please share your screen?
Okay, just a minute. I hope it was there. Just give me a minute. All right, so hope now you can.
Yes, it's visible now, thanks.
Yeah, all right, thank you. Thanks for telling me that. All right, so what I was saying that, you know, I just come back to my the main one. So this is where I talk about, okay, let me go to the cluster that just now I have created. This is up and running with those compute power because I need to run something on top of my Databricks compute platform. So this is the cluster. So it give me a GPU and other related compute power that I can run my code. So now I have to bring my code. So what code that I want to run? So I'll go to the workspace that I can go, and this is my workspace currently, and I can go and import a file. So I can go and say a browse. And I go and import that a file. So this file, the step number one, I need to go and mount the blob storage. The mounting blob storage means like the blob storage what we have created some time back, where I have created my container, and under the container and I upload the zip file, and zip file is going to give me a 2000 images of different type of image, or different kind of different type of images, maybe image from aeroplane or image from a dog or a cat or something like that. The 2000 images available, and those images will be going into a deep learning, you know, neural network. So the first I have to make that particular data available to the platform from where I'm going to run my code. So in order to making that data available to the current context, I'll go and get my storage account name and the storage account key. So let me go to my storage account. I'll go to this access key from the storage account, and I'll get the name, copy this, and I will replace the storage account name. And then the account key. So here is the account key. I'll get the account key and replace this account key from here itself. And the container name, as you have seen before also, if I go to an overview and then container, we do have a container names with the same container that we are talking about, 2000 PIC CIFAR 10. So here is the same container that we are talking about. So this is one set of command that we want to run. So it's basically setting the parameter. So here I can go and say run that one. So you said, do you want me to? Yes. So this is done. And then we'll go to the second one. So from where I want to mount the blob storage under which that file is available, then we can unzip to all 2000 images. So here I don't change anything. So like go and run this. So in case you have a cluster with a zero worker, that is we have, you need to cancel the statement manually after 30 seconds. So that is what I'm going to do it, because otherwise it will start an Spark job, you know, which cannot be executed, you know. So something like, since there are zero workers, so it would be just hanging around that. So we'll stop manually in 30 seconds from now. So what I'm doing through this piece of code, so you are mounting that the directories. That directory is nothing but a container name that we are talking about. That need to be mounted with this particular mount point, so from where the data can be read. So I'll cancel now. So, and now if I try and run again, it'll say this would be mounted. So directory, this is already being mounted. So the job is done. Then we do an unzip. So it will take approximately 2 minutes to unzip those images that we see. This is the zip file, so that you need to unzip, and then you can see that the unzipping would be completed in 2 minutes. Now if I go and refresh, the unzipping may be started now. Then you can see, because we are doing it from here itself, the Python command that we are running by mounting the blob storage, which is connected to this notebook that I am running at this moment. Right, so that is something that we can always see. So these are, you can create a new notebooks or current notebook that you are running at this moment, or you can delete, or you can see all those things that you want to go and see. So the command successfully executed. So this is also done. Now, in fact, if I go back and refresh my, so I can see the list of images out there along with the zip file. So that is, these are the images with the PNG file is being unzipped. And then we go and, you know, try and see the list of images. Maybe I can go and say, okay, from here itself, from the Python code, if it is mounted, you can see these are huge list. It means it would be a 2000 image that you get it. This is also fine. Okay, as an output of this particular command, it is just a Linux command. As I said, on the notebook, we can run the Linux shell command also. So hh is basically create a shell, and then you go and give this command what you are looking at, ls command, the list this image. And to just to see the picture that everything is fine, so I should be able to get those picture, the images right below. So then will be done that my storage would be well connected and ready for deep learning computing that is going to happen on my images. So you can see the list of images right there. Okay, so this is again kind of, you know, keep loading an image in the 10, the number of the columns under which that image to be coming in. So you can go and plot. This is just a testing. It is not getting 2000 images back here, but yes, the image is being, and these are the categories that we are talking about. So here is a aeroplanes or automobile, bird, cat, deer, dog, frog, horse, and ship and truck. So these are, so you can see those things. So these are our categories that we talked about. So we are done with the mounting of the storage account, and then we are done with, you know, unzipping all the image. Now we are done with viewing the image, means we are ready for a deep learning computing on top of this cluster that we have created. So let's go and get the next a file. So import a new file. So deep learning. So currently I am here. You can always go to the Azure Databricks and you can see the list of, you know, the recent tasks that you did it under a particular node. So you can always go to this one, click, it will take me there itself. So the Databricks will give you a dashboard and you can move from one to another. Currently I am in a notebook and where I'm going to run. So where I'm going to run the deep learning, the models that we have been talking about. Okay, so the first thing that we go and mount map, that is, we know that this is the mounting kind of locations from where I can find the data. So this data that we are talking about, so let me go and run this one. Yes, this is done. Load all the libraries that we talk about. I have given the definitions of the Keras that we talked about. This is the deep learning API that is going to learn on the inbuilt TensorFlow 2.0 environment, the machine learning environment, ML environments, and that is implicitly backed by the Databricks at this moment. And we should be able to go and include the respective modules or respective, you know, kind of the components of who can deal with the deep learning or creating neural, the network that we are talking about to identify . So give me a minute here. This is done. So just give me a minute to, I can see a few things there. All right, so let me see the previous one, like build a model on the 200 pixel of this from the storage account. Let me see that. Just give me one more minute, so I'll okay, just give me so just give me a minute. I don't know what happened with that. So let me see this once again. So let me restart my cluster with a few. Update within ML related libraries to be present. So just it will take 2 more minutes. So we'll come back and start running those code. So give me 2 more minutes. So once it is done, we can come back and press. Still restarting. So restarting this deep learning cluster is almost like redeploying that one. So you just need to be with me for some time. So once you back, we can go back to the notebook and start running those. See, anyway, we are not supposed to go back and, you know, try and find out all the programming nitty gritty of the deep learning, but you need to get a fair idea because it's all about getting into that world and talking about all those APIs, all those, the syntax that you need to kind of learn in order to do the programming using those libraries that I'm talking about. So the machine learning, the libraries need to be made available to the cluster, so which was missing before. So I'm trying to pull it, and now I can come back and see. Still go to the recent one. But without cluster, we won't be able to run things at this moment. So we just need to see our cluster is still running. Otherwise, it won't be able to connect the restarting the cluster. So. Okay, so now it is up and running. Now I can go back to my the recent notebook that I'm working so far. So let me mount it once again. So this is the previous one. Is a situations which is there on the cloud. It cannot be predicted any given point in time. It's up to them sometimes, you know, the compute. Yeah, so that is run successfully. Okay, this is also fine. And now I can go back and run this. So we'll wait for some time to. So this is basically the loaded pixels, like 100 of 2000. So this is basically going and build the models on 2000 pixels on the storage account. So this is something like category list. So these are input data that we are talking about as identify as a number and so on and so forth. So once you're done with this 2000, so we can move into the next. So the data resupple and split between the train and the test, because that's what we need to understand the basic of the machine learning, because you assume that machine learning would be known to you at this moment. So 1800, 1900, and finally 2000 pixels is loaded. Now ready for the train. So here, but before we train, we split it like how we do in the machine learning. This is also done, and we put a batch size of those data. This is because the deep learning concept we talk about EPOS and all. And then we started the processing state, convert the class vector to a binary class matrix, as I said before also. And then we started talking about the training by calling and the Keras utility by using classifications model at this moment. Right, so this is where we talk about the neural networks, you know. So how many kind of networks that you want to go and add, you know. So this is, and what goes inside that one layer of network. And finally, the network outcome has to be a model. So this programming things, the skill that I'm talking about will take some time. So I'm not here to just to explain line by line, but I'll give you the ideas. So how we are going to write your net, because the neural network that we have been talking about, which is the inherent part of the deep learning. So this is how we do. So this is the brain of your deep learning activity that you are going to do. So who basically started learning the features from your incoming data and come to a conclusion. So let's go and run that also. So we need to create a model here, because that is the outcome model that you are going to get it. This is fine. This is a bit of warning that we are getting, and we get a kind of summary out there. So this is a kind of summary that we are talking about, the layer types. So these are the different layers, you know, the output shape and all these things, they're coming in. So total parameters. So all this, the deep learning concept that we see this, you know, so define and optimize the compile and model kind of stuff. This is also optimizer from the Keras itself. The learning rate, and we talk about all this stuff, hyperparameters. And the model trainings without data augmentations, the task one. So this is your model. This is all the configurations with an X test and a Y test that you are going to have. So this is how this. So is there any loss of data in terms of creating a model? So you'll get a fair idea of that. So these are very, very the inside data. And then before we go and evaluate the model, evaluate model is basically whether I'm satisfied with the model or do I have to get. So the model score at this, so the accuracy is like 42% to predict something. Maybe the list of images or maybe number of images may be less. The total accuracy that we are getting in 42% and the loss of data may be 1.51. And then going forward with this. So you can really go and do some kind of visualizations on the data. You know, so by putting them together, so it's basically a kind of working with legend and all these things, the other data is going to come in. So finally we can go and run this by using Matplot libraries. That is what we are talking about. The visualizing the model, how this model is being trained and test. Model accuracy that we are talking about, plotting in the graph. So now coming, so once you have created the model by using the neural networks, once you have evaluated the model with the accuracies, in what accuracy that model is going to predict the images that we need to test. So if I want to test the same set of images against the a model that we have created, so how accurate that model would be the predicting the incoming images, that we can go and get them on the. So this is something that we are going to go and get it right below. So this is something that. So the rate that you are talking about means because of this accuracy, they are not able to predict. Like suppose you said there is a deer, but it said bird. So the wrong predictions is being done because the accuracy of the model is less, because the deep learning always need the huge amount of data to learn from the data and in order to predict this data right there. Now, what if I go and increase the number of images, and then we need to go back and see how accurately my deep learning model can predict the incoming, you know, the images. So here is a lot of, you know, the unpredictable data that we can see, the red one, it's not able to predict at this moment. And we can save those and we can raise. I said saving, I will not do that, and creating another application and calling the model from those applications, maybe the web application or mobile application and so on and so forth. But here we are learning more on the deep learning algorithms and deep learning code and to just to go and predict. So this time we are going to go with the 6,000 pixel with the same set, and then we'll see how accuracy the will come or increase or improve in terms of predicting the incoming images. So let us go get it directly from the resources, which is available out there. So setting the same stuff that we did before. But this time the number of images, the number of the kind of the count would be increased. So it's a full model that we are initializing, not only like 2000 model that we did before. The same things, optimizer that we are using, talking about learning rate that we discussed. So in order to work with those data, the training model, because this training will take some time, so it should be done in 5 minutes, because this is something, the actual computing that I'm talking about at this moment to go with. And then probably we can bring them to plot by using Matplot libraries to display all of them. And this is the neural network that we talk about. The same thing, define a CN. Still going on. And then we will be evaluating the model. So primarily this is the core stuff. You can see that this is the core stuff, that how many layers that we'll be creating and how those layer would be configured. And this is the core thing that I'm repeatedly talking about as a developer, the AI developer for tomorrow's. Just need to understand those syntax and understand the APIs. First, you need to go back and learn as a Keras, as a traditional programming, and then we come back and integrate it with the existing platforms like your the Databrick, because Databrick is implicitly offering all those API from that compute power that we associate with. Okay, so I don't need to additionally go and do things on my own. So that is a kind of optimized environment that we are working currently. So notebook is an amazing space where we can run those code, which is not only related to a data science or a deep learning code. It could be a typical machine learning or maybe some kind of the code that will associate with the as your data factories and cognitive service and so on and so forth. or maybe, you know, reusing the model that you have created by using some sort of custom visions, and then, you know, so working with those model back in the Databricks notebook, what we are doing. So give me two more minutes. So you can see that the train on 5,000 sample and validate on 1,000 sample, you know, so in the rate. So this is a kind of with an epoch of 1/30. So 30 time learning is happening on the one image in a big computing. So that is what we keep telling it. So you need the underlying computing infrastructure any given point in time. And because we are doing on top of Microsoft Azure and the Databricks platform, so that's why we don't need to worry, because although we just set the auto scaling off, but if I on the auto scaling, so any given point in time, if you need more resources, so you can get more computing on the fly. So your work will not stop because of the resources or because of out of memories or out of computing power. So that is the beauty of working with Microsoft Azure in the AI solution, whether it is deep learning or maybe a machine learning, the things remain the same. So I'll go with this, evaluate the model at this moment. So let me. Still going on because of that, it is waiting for the previous one. So once we are done with that, so then we can go with the evaluating models, and then we can see, then we are again printing those images like how we printed on the top to see how accurately my model is responsible for predicting those images. So traditionally, the difference between the machine learning and the deep learning is that the machine learning can work in the low number of input data, but deep learning need more data to predict or to go with the accuracy. Because along with the machine learning, we'll tag them. We just tell them what type of image that I'm bypassing or what type of image that I'm uploading for training, that already being tagged, already being labeled. The features is being supplied from the outside world. But here you need to learn features from there itself. So then you need more data. So learning has to happen on more data, not like a small amount of data like 2000, because we are splitting across the 10 different, you know, the categories that need to learn. So So anyway, sometime from now, that has to happen. It should not take so long, but yes, it is taking too long at this moment. But what I'm saying, so yes, it is done now. We go with this evaluating the model. So evaluating the model, you can see the accuracy that we get last time 41. Now you're getting 76 and with the loss of 71. So now probably almost everything can be predicted because it's a really good accuracy number that we are getting out there. Right, so let me just go back and present my data in the predictions out there. So this is how the testing is being done so far. And let me plot it. So here we are. So now in this case, you have very less number which cannot be predicted in compared to the previous one. You can see this. So the predictions in the plot, that is what we are predictions that we are talking about. So if you compare to the previous one, the previous ones, the accuracy was not kind of, you know, accepted the numbers. Now it is accepted. It is above 70% of the accuracies by going that logic, by going that model. So you're able to kind of the predict stuff out there. But still we can improve, we can go back and do this every now and then. And then again, we are saving it and, you know, so all these things that we can do and run it from a different file system as a model, and we can run it from, or we can expose as an HTTP endpoint, and we can always. So net coming back to the deep, coming back to our Azure Databricks, what we did. So we have mounted the storage. We write a deep learning notebook, Python code using neural networks in order to learn features from the 2000 images or learn features from the 6000 images, as you can see. So learning from more images will more give more predictability, and that is the thumb, you know, rules going with the deep learning, because the deep learning does not require any additional input, unlike the machine learning that we do the labeling, you know, typically in the traditional machine learning. Right, so this is what I just need to give a demo, so to give you a fair idea. As I said, we can save them. So whatever we have done so far, because model is already created, I can save it in a physical disk, and that can be exposed or that can be used from the underlying applications in the near future. So let me take you back to the presentations, one or two things more that I need to talk about, and then we will wind up for today's session. So give me a minute. So in the development context, you know, when you develop something, you know, so you use either one of this language that you are working on. Like, for example, Python is the kind of the, you know, the prerequisite, because all the machine learning libraries is being written on the Pythons. But today the .NET also has come in that the space, and you as a .NET developers, you can make use of ML.NET libraries, and that can be incorporated from your .NET application, maybe a .NET application like web applications or maybe a desktop application, or maybe a .NET Xamarin applications that you develop for.
Hello, sir. So we can't hear you.
Looks like disconnected. Because I am able to hear you, I hope you are also able to hear me.
Yes, give me a moment.
I'm really sorry because it got disconnected in between. So there's a bit of a problem in. So I could reconnect and, so coming back to my presentation. So I'm about to finish this today's webinar. So I just wanted to give you a bit of ideas, like for .NET developers, you can go back and you can see that what is ML.NET. to work with the deep learning neural networks, so all the libraries available that you can make use of from the .NET one. So this is how the image classifier can be worked with ML.NET out there, right? So these are basically few informations that I just wanted to do and give it. So, but yes, today's presentation so far, I need to do only what we have been discussing, I mean, basically learning the concept of the deep learning and how we can set it up, the deep learning environment on Microsoft Azure. But apart from that, it is not only Azure. So you can have your own infrastructure and you can have your own, you know, .NET libraries, ML.NET, and you can start writing a deep learning application. So that's it for today's session. So how we can build deep learning applications using Azure services. And I would like to thank all of you. And it's a series, and subsequently we will go and learn. So subsequently we are going to learn more on this subject, because there are a lot of upcoming meetup sessions that we are going to do in that context. So today it was a kind of getting to know the Azure platforms and the deep learning as a concept and how it can be implemented. But going forward, we'll working on an applications who can call those deep learning model from here onwards. Right, so thank you once again. At the end, it was a network disturbance, so sorry for that. But yes, this is what I supposed to do, and hope to see you all in the next upcoming meetup with a different topic. Thanks once again.
Thank you so much, Navjyoti sir, and thanks everyone for joining us for today's meetup. So I have shared my mail ID in the chat. So if anyone want the participation certificate, just mail me on that. Just mail your details to me. And for the recording, in next 1 or 2 weeks, we will share this recording in our YouTube channel, so you can directly access from there. And for the presentation, we can't able to share this presentation, so you need to visit our YouTube channel for the webinar recording. Thank you once again. Thank you, everyone.